Well, they can take action. They just need to know.
We call this board meeting to order. First request is a motion for President Pro Tem.
I move that Crystal Hansen serve as President Pro Tem for tonight's meeting.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris?
Here.
Member Campbell?
I'm staying because I'm confused. I didn't know that you had to. I thought she automatically moved in that seat, so I don't know what I'm doing, so I'm abstaining.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hansen?
Yes. All right, we'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Member Boudouris?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If we could, at this moment, just take a moment of silence for Dante Randolph, who lost his life just a few weeks ago. Thank you. All right. Member Sikora, could you read our board mission statement?
Sure. Our mission is to ensure that all students are prepared for college and a successful life academically, socially, and emotionally, as well as equipped with the necessary tools to have options and make decisions about their long-term goals. This will be accomplished by believing and working towards all students learning through rigorous curricula and meaningful, effective instruction, consequently demonstrating mastery on high-quality assessments, with all stakeholders being held accountable throughout the process.
Thank you. Superintendent Jim Mitchum, our agenda?
Yes, Mrs. Hansen. I'd like to ask that the board approve the agenda as presented. So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
No.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hansen?
Yes. Treasurer's report?
You may recall on March 4th, we had moved that meeting up. At that time, we had presented a bill list, so you do not have a bill list for tonight's meeting, but you do have the Treasurer's Report for consideration and action, which includes our typical monthly financials, our balance sheets, summary of revenue and expenditures, as well as interim obligation payments for April 2015, totaling $3,304,647.89.
Motion and a second?
So move.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hansen?
Yes.
We also have the information report, summary of investments for April, the state funding update, which if you take a look at that, not a whole lot to report. You'll have a listing there for general state aid hold harmless, $757,000. It's due and owed, but that was something new that the state was putting out. And so I will not consider that late until June. So that'll be worth monitoring, but I just wanted to make a note of that. Also have all the school's trust account activity for March 31st, 2015. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them at this time.
Are there any questions from the board about the information Mr. Gazzoffi has given us? All right. Consent agenda items.
Yes, I'd like to ask that the board approve consent agenda items 6-1 through 6-8. 6-1, approval of board meeting minutes for 5-4-15. 6-2, executive session meeting minutes, 5-4-15. 6-3, gifts for Tibbett Elementary School, Brooks Middle School, and STEP. 6-4, trips for Jonas Salk Elementary School and Bolingbrook High School. 6-5, student activity contract for Irene King Elementary with Innsbruck Wraps. 6-6, student activity contracts for K.L. Hermanson Elementary with Anderson Book Fair. 6-7, Valley View Enrichment Foundation, 2015-2016 grant awards, And 6-8, recommendation to extend related services contract with Easter Seals Joliet Region Incorporated.
So moved.
Seconded.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perro?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. Student and staff recognition. I believe we're beginning with Bolingbrook High School and Principal Jordan. And Member Campbell?
Good evening, Vice President Hanson, School Board, Superintendent Mitchum, Senior Leadership, and VVS Community. It is with great pleasure that Bolingbrook High School recognizes Nancy Clemens as a pillar of Valley View. During Nancy's 21 years in education, she has been a media specialist, world history teacher, director of guidance and counselor. Currently, Nancy is the assessment coordinator and ESL counselor at BHS. And with this year with Park, that has been a significant contribution to our school. Nancy has developed and implemented a college and career curriculum for the ESL students, organized a special CCR speaker forum, assumed all counseling duties for ESL, and is a member of the Bilingual Parent Council. She is responsible for the Illinois State Scholar Submissions, organizing FAFSA completion nights and parent nights. She has also voluntarily organized and implemented ACT prep activities for students. Over the years at BHS, Nancy has been on the following committees: school climate, student assistant program, character counts, ad council, district course catalog committee, seal of biliteracy, and five essential surveys. Spare time for Nancy, which she doesn't have much, means spending time with her family, her sons Tim, Christopher, and Brad and his wife Casey is here this evening, along with his sons Tucker and Griffin. For all her contributions, Nancy is a tremendous asset to the Bolingbrook High School staff. Congratulations, Nancy, and thank you for all you do.
Next up, Brooks Middle School with Principal Dr. Keith Wood and Member Sikora.
Good evening, board members, Dr. Mitchum, parents, students and community members. I am Loretta Fertute, one of the assistant principals at Brooks Middle School. And it is truly an honor to stand before you this evening and acknowledge Heather Southcombe as a pillar of Valley View School District. Heather is an eighth grade language arts and special education co-teacher at Brooks Middle School. She is definitely an asset to our community of learners. She is dedicated to her craft and, more importantly, committed to the academic well-being of all students. The countless hours of preparation of content, dedication to excellence, and rigor has provided many of her students with the ability to exceed beyond their expectations. She supports her peers by listening, offering advice and strategies, but also committing to developing a rapport with all stakeholders. Heather is hardworking, dedicated, and flexible, putting the needs of students first. As stated by several of her peers, Heather has such a positive attitude and never seems to be overwhelmed by the many responsibilities she has, especially the ones Ms. Fertute often asks her to do. She goes above and beyond to understand the language arts curriculum and still doesn't slack on her special education responsibilities. She is a master at multitasking and doesn't ever seem to be panicked by it. It's seriously amazing, and I wish I was as calm as Heather. Another peer says, Heather is always ready to take on a challenge, whether it is with a new task in the building, talking to a difficult student or demanding parent, or just being at a school event. Heather is the epitome of a pillar of Valley View, The administrative team and staff at Brooks Middle School would like to recognize Heather Southcomb as a pillar of Valley View School District.
Thank you.
Okay. Wait. Oh, one more. One more picture. Okay. Next up, we have Pioneer Elementary School with Principal Carmen Killingsworth and Member Felice.
Good evening, Valley View School District Board of Education, senior leadership, and the entire VVSD community. It is our absolute pleasure to introduce you to our pioneer pillars of Valley View, Beth Giesler, Jackie Dupre, Deb Blum, and Patty Ariola, Pioneer's front office professionals. They are truly the backbone of our school and provide exceptional service to all students, staff, parents, and community stakeholders. They work closely together to cover the hundreds of phone calls and requests presented each day from our staff, our students, our parents, and our district office. They are the welcoming gateway to our school, and they do it with a smile each day. They are not always able to make everyone happy, but they are always available and ready to serve everyone. Not only do they help our guests in the building, they also work closely with our teaching staff to prepare materials for classroom instruction, to assist in the organization of school-wide events, and to help our teachers communicate effectively with our parent volunteers, etc. They have pressed the buzzer to the academic wing over 100 times a day. They've taken and made thousands of calls regarding student attendance. They've called for a cleanup in a classroom more times than we can count. They walk our halls to get students for early dismissal. Try this one. They've taught our little ones how to use a landline phone. That's not it. And they've processed hundreds of young authors' books. They found children who decided on their own to change their route home after dismissal, etc. They do this and so much more every single day with grace and a positive attitude. All members of our front office staff are also VVSD parents. Their children range from middle schoolers through a recent college graduate. And one of our front office staff members, Mrs. Blum, is also a product of Valley View Schools. We're so proud. Words cannot express our gratitude for the commitment and dedication to exceptional service to the entire Pioneer School community. They are indeed pillars of Valley View. Thank you and congratulations.
Lots of hugs going on. All righty, and finally we have a community partner pillar with Michelle Boschnick, who's our community outreach coordinator, and member Diane Perro.
Good evening, senior leadership, board members, Dr. Mitchum, and our community.
Today I'm very excited to be here with members of Emerging Life Solution, who supports our community in a very different way. I'm Michelle Boschnick. I'm the Community Outreach Coordinator for Valley View School District, and one of the groups of families that we support are those that are homeless in our community. In Will County, we have over 1,600 homeless children, and in our district, we have 300. We all know that breaking the cycle of poverty is what's really important for these students that are homeless. And Valley View has many programs in place to help achieve that. But we need community assistance also. Some of the challenges for our families who experience homelessness involve struggling daily for stability, for food, shelter, and clothing, to attend school regularly, and to concentrate on education. We are here to honor community partner, Emerging Life Solutions. Their mission is to equip youth to reach their destiny by providing the resources necessary to fulfill their immediate needs. This outreach program began at Living Waters Community Church and became a 501(c) nonprofit organization. How they help us? They provide fast stopgap funding not covered by Title I grants, and they give us access to other community outreach organizations and programs. They provide shelter. Oftentimes we have families that lose housing immediately and they need to stay in a hotel. With stability, they give us funds toward first month's rent, and they give us tools to access other community assistance. Sometimes we can find organizations that will give a house full of furniture, but we need a truck to get the furniture delivered to the people, or we need the $50 fee. And this is how Emerging Life Solutions helps us. For the past 2 years, Emerging Life Solutions has paid over $4,000 directly to hotels, furniture outlets, and landlords for our homeless community. I would like to present some awards to a couple of the board members that are here with us today. Alicia Taylor, Monica Guillory, and someone who helps me a lot is Maureen Schaefer. But I would also like to give special recognition to Crystal Hansen, who saw the need for Emerging Life Solutions several years ago when she was pastor at Living Waters Community Church. Alicia? Could we have Crystal in the picture too?
Alrighty, we have next up IHSA State Badminton Qualifier, Romeoville High School with Principal Kinder and Little Kinder.
Yes, he takes more patience than all 1,800 kids to be with for an hour and a half every day.
Sure,
no.
He does.
Good evening, Vice President Hansen, Secretary Sikora, members of the board, Dr. Mitchum, senior leadership, members of the community, and members of the audience. It gives me great pleasure to announce our head varsity badminton coach, Mr. Chaz Kuhn, who's going to introduce our first ever Romeoville High School state badminton qualifier. Mr. Kuhn.
Thank you very much to the school board and senior leadership for giving me a platform to brag about Angelia one last time before she graduates and moves on. Angelia played 4 years for me. She was the captain of the team that had 65 girls on it. Angelia, just to give her some stats, she has 30 wins in a season, which is the most all-time at Romeoville, 50 career all-time wins. And to put it in perspective, they probably play 12 head-to-head games all year. So she's winning, like this year she went 30-9. So she's winning a majority of her games. She's a three-time all-conference player. She's an all-sectional player. She's a first state qualifier for Romeyville High School in badminton. She's the first badminton player for the district to win a game at state. She went 1-2. She ended up losing to the three-time state champ. She's a hard worker. I think her best quality in sports is all turning to analytics now. But I think one of her best qualities is that she's stoic and she doesn't get too high or too low, and she stays the course and she trusts in herself, which will help her next year at UIC. She's going to major in biology. She wants to be a physician. So you want your doctors to be kind of even keeled. You don't want them to look at something and be like, I don't know what this is. But she is really going to be missed. And I think we say that often, but I really believe it with her. Going to miss her. Thank you for everything you've done for the program. Congratulations for you, and you deserve all the accolades you get.
Alrighty, and next up we have the VVSD Middle School Math Contest winners. Giving those awards are Ms. Fay.
Good evening, Secretary Sikora, Vice President Hansen, board members, senior leadership, and the community. We are here tonight to celebrate our Valley View School District Middle School Math Contest. This was our fifth math contest, and we're first going to have our individual winners come on up and be recognized. So if you're out there, why don't you come on up to the left of me and we'll do names, and you can line up by grade level. That would be helpful. All right, at the sixth grade level, in second place from Humphrey Middle School is Harold Arigia. And at the sixth grade level in first place was Josh Ribiawick. At the second grade level, in second place from Jane Addams Middle School, Jack McDermott. And in first place from Jane Addams Middle School, Joseph Bayless. At eighth grade, we had a tie for second place from two different schools. First from Lukanzik, Peter Zawulski. And, sorry, go ahead. And from AVM, Lynette Lopez. And in first place from AVM, Lynette Lopez. And at the algebra level, we had in second place from Jane Addams, Mark Liu. And in first place from Jane Addams, Charlie Steenstra. At this time, I'm going to have Carrie Locke from Jane Addams Middle School come on up. They were our winning school, and she's going to introduce her team.
Good evening, Board of Education, Administration, and parents and friends of all the people that are here tonight. Wonderful. I'm going to be reading all the names of the students that were on the team that competed in the district championship, and I just have to put this out there. Yes, we were three-peat champions. Please don't sue me, New York person that coined that phrase. I think he actually trademarked it, but don't tell anybody. All right, Jamal Viarola, who is not with us this evening. Joe Bayless, Peyton Eakin, a three-time Mathlete member. Tess Egan, her sister, thankfully, coming up. Thank you, Tess. Mitch Fry, a three-time mathlete. Josh Currian, not with us this evening. Mark Liu, not with us this evening. Christian Martinez, not with us this evening. Emily McKeever, not with us this evening. Jack McDermott. Christian Melendez. Trevor Mormon. Kate Nadzella. Naomi Pupulapade. Jacob McWilliams. Megan O'Donnell. Josh Ribialik. Charlie Steenstra, a three-time member of the Mathletes. Danny Steenstra, a two-time member. Jolin Zhang, a three-time member. And a member of Mathletes, Annabeth Young. Thank you.
Sorry, I got a little tongue-tied. I wanted to say that Eric Nelson from ABM was the tie for second place at eighth grade, and we said Lynette Lopez twice. So I just want to recognize Eric. He did walk through and shake everyone's hand.
Nice job, everyone. Keep excelling in your math. Lead you into some great careers. For parents and those of you that came to see the awards, we want to say go ahead and go on home. While we all wish it was summer and there was no school tomorrow, we still have a little bit of school left. Alrighty, moving down our agenda, we'll begin with liaison reports. Any from my right? Any from my left? Deb?
With it being the end of the year, wanted to recognize some Valley View Schools Students of the Year for 2015. I think they deserve some special recognition along with some scholarship winners. Congratulations to Nicholas Soltow in auto body from Bolingbrook High School, Student of the Year. Student of the Year, Adam Patton in computer tech from Bolingbrook High School. Student of the Year, Ashley Allen in criminal justice from Bolingbrook High School. Student of the Year, Hannah Eichelberger in culinary arts from Romeoville High School. Student of the Year, Caitlin Olson in early childhood from Romeoville High School. And Student of the Year, Zachary Stebbick in welding from Bolingbrook High School. Also briefly, the National Technical Honor Society gives out some awards annually. In order to qualify, you have to have at least a 3.0 grade point average at their home school in all classes, 5 absences or less, no unexcused absences, and they have to complete at least 10 hours of community service. And I think if we had everybody doing that, we'd have a heck of a student class. But just to listen to some of these in auto body, the Will County Auto Rebuilder Scholarship was given to Nicholas Soltow from Bolingbrook High School. Certified Nursing Assistant Scholarships were given to Mariana Boschnick from Romeoville High School, Maria Diaz from Romeoville High School, Michelle Soto from Romeoville High School, and Brianna Vira from Romeoville High School. The Wilco Chapter HOSA Scholarship went to Michelle Soto from Romeoville High School. And Culinary Arts, Hannah Eichelberger from Romeoville High School. The State FCCLA Finalist, the National Delegates in Hospitality, Tourism, and Recreation, second place. Congratulations to Hannah Eichelberger from Romeoville. In Cake Decorating, first place, Carolyn Labica from Romeoville High School. Culinary Sullivan University Scholarship, which is a $6,000 scholarship. Congratulations to Carolyn Labica from Romeoville High School. $4,000 Sullivan Scholarship was given to Hannah Eichelberger from Romeoville High School. The Johnston and Wales Scholarship, a $750 quarterly award, was given to Hannah Eichelberger from Romeoville. The Kendall College Scholarship for a $750 quarterly award, again to Hannah Eichelberger. can see that's why she was probably Student of the Year as well. Citizenship Award, which is a new award that the Wilco gives out, was given out to James Camparetto from Romeoville High School, and Wilco Scholarship to Caitlin Olson from Romeoville High School. Citizenship Award in Early Childhood was given out to Elizabeth Jobin from Romeoville High School. Introduction to Health Professions, Gloria Owen Angaya from Romeoville High School and Andrea Reed from Romeoville High School. The last one that I wanted to, the Wilco Star Scholarship, given out, a new one this year, was given out to Jose Vasquez from Romeoville High School. If you ever want to hear a good story, look him up at the high school. He's got one heck of a story to tell. So, thank you.
I have a couple reports. The Mastery Learning and Assessment meeting was held today. We're working on making language consistent so that all people involved are held accountable. Also attended the Alternative to Assessment meeting a couple weeks ago. Discussion of organizations and or businesses that would allow students to do community service. Ms. Johnstone explained that the person at the place who is going to be in charge of this person doing, the child doing community service, does have to have a background check, so the community is aware of that. Ms. Johnstone will conduct the search for organizations that will allow students to do community service this summer. Training will be then conducted for school personnel involved in this, as well as the representative from the organization. Thank you.
All right, any other liaison reports? All righty, action report. Superintendent?
Audience participation.
Oh, I'm sorry, audience participation. All right. We come forward, state your name, where you're from. Seeing none. All right, moving on. Action reports. Superintendent.
Yes, Mitchell. Vice President Hanson, I'd like to ask that the board approve student due process cases A through H as presented.
Motion and a second.
So move.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. Action reports. Assistant Superintendent Rachel Kinder.
No report this evening.
All right. Action report. Assistant Superintendent of Administrative Service, Gary Kuzafi.
Three actions this evening, all of which were presented as information at our previous board meeting. First is the Jonas Salk Elementary Site Improvement Phase 2. We are recommending accepting Orange Crush as the lowest bidder, including alternates 1, 2, and 3 in the base, with the base bid for a total amount of $300,000 to be incorporated in the FY15-16 Building Operations and Maintenance Budget.
Second. A second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none, roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
Second action is a recommendation to renew the GCA cleaning contract for all of our schools throughout the district. The company has been with us since 1997. Comprises 140 custodians throughout all of our sites. And the recommendation is to renew a one-year contract extension in the amount of $3,379,437, which represents a 2% increase over the prior year.
Motion and second?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Just real quick, with regards to the insurance portion of that, just to refresh my memory, their families will still be able to partake in the insurance from the janitors' families will still be able to partake in insurance.
Insurance is provided, single or family. I'm not sure if they have a plus one or not. We had talked at length, both internally and with legal, about having this more as presented more as a pass-through, and the sense was that we'd rather just keep that as a cost of the company and not kind of put it back in our lap, so to speak. Part of the reason for the increase was indeed the fact that they were being required via the Affordable Care Act to provide insurance to all of their employees and families.
Wow, one other quick question. How often does their management meet with members of your direct staff, whether that's Mr. Lopez or whoever.
Yeah, typically Mike will meet with them at least every month. They've got a site supervisor that is accessible every day, and we'll check in periodically if there's an issue. But they have been here for quite some time, and things run pretty well. So, but we do meet with them monthly.
Do you have a contact at each school that sort of is the super the site contact for the janitor service?
Typically, it would be that site supervisor for the district. It would not be per building.
But I'm talking as far as the Valley View. Is there a person like at Bolingbrook High School? Is there a person at Romanville that's the go-to if there's a problem with?
Typically, their lead is a district lead, not a site lead.
Okay, all right.
That's
Thanks.
The way they structure that.
Any other discussion? Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
Final action this evening is a recommendation to replace the north domed roof at A.V. Vito Martinez Middle School. We are recommending going with the lowest bidder, Bennett Brousseau Roofing from Romeyville, Illinois. Happy to report that they have done the prior two phases of work at AVM, so they're certainly familiar with the site and the work involved. And so we are again recommending Bennett Brousseau for the partial roof replacement at AV Vito Martinez, the amount of $376,750.
Your motion and second?
So moved.
Seconded.
Discussion? Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
Could I ask a question of Gary before we go on? Gary, are we going to, last year we did the first phase for the heating and air conditioning at Brooks Middle School, and it was brought to my attention that we're not doing phase two this year?
It has certainly not come to the board. I'm hoping to present that in Finance Committee. I want to look at this holistically in terms of Brooks as well as all the other needs in the district. To see, make sure that our priorities in terms of the administrative side are the priorities of the board. That work certainly is still a high priority for us, and that will need to be, again, just factored into all the work that needs to be done district-wide.
Okay. Did we vote on that last year to do all three phases?
Or? We did not. We only approved phase one, which was the chiller replacement and the boiler replacement.
All right, moving down the agenda, action reports by Executive Director Sharon Hawks.
Thank you. Action report 13.1 is the consolidated action report for certified and classified personnel. This evening, we're seeking your approval on 108 items for certified personnel, 76 for classified, 2 for administrative classified, and 2 for administrative certified personnel.
Motion and second?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. With the board's approval of the consolidated action report, they just approved the appointment of Mrs. Jackie Mitchum to serve as co-principal at Independence Elementary School with Mrs. Mulcahy for the 15-16 school year. And then she will assume the principalship of Independence for the 16-17 school year when Mrs. Mulcahy retires. So, Mrs. Mitchum, if you'd like to come up to the podium and greet the community.
Good evening, Vice President Hanson, the board, senior leadership, and the rest of our community out there, and my peers. I'm honored and excited to return to Independence as the co-principal for the upcoming school year. I can assure you that I will work tirelessly along Ms. Mulcahy and her team to continue the traditions Independence has and support all its successes. I look forward to Ms. Mulcahy's mentorship and her expertise. Thank you for your confidence and this opportunity to be a part of making Independence Elementary School the best that it can be. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Moving on to my next action report, 13.2, it is resolution number 1521. We're recommending the board's approval of the resolution authorizing dismissal of educational support personnel employee for reasons other than reduction in force.
Motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
No.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perro?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. And my final action report this evening is 13.3. This is regarding administrative job descriptions. At the last board meeting, we brought as an information report the early childhood assistant principal job description. So this evening, we're recommending your approval of the proposed administrative job description.
So moved.
Second.
I have a question. This is with the understanding that if that grant money goes away for that position, that we will reassess that as to whether we have the money to continue with that, correct?
That is correct.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Roll call vote.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perro?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. Superintendent's information reports.
First information report is an annual district software services renewal. We bring this forward annually, combining all of the major software packages that allow us to operate on a day-to-day basis. We've got 6 instructional software support renewals, along with 6 operational software support renewals included in the information report, with the understanding that we would bring this forward at our next meeting for action. We do have something new on the list, and that's the Follett Destiny Library and Resource Manager. This will be used to inventory all of our textbooks in a more computerized fashion, allowing us at a glimpse to see where we have excess inventory, where we have needs, also allowing our elementaries to maintain and track the many components of the curriculum that have been incorporated over the last many years. So you'll see a cost there of about $48,500, which equates to about $2,200 per site. This will be a phased-in approach, most likely being implemented at the high school first, both high schools and the elementaries on a as-needed basis, if you will. The schools need to be ready, and we want to roll this out slowly so that we have good implementation, and the middle school is probably following off behind. After that, annually, the cost will be reduced to $550 per site. This is a hosted solution, bringing our annual cost down to about just a little over $12,000. Questions on anything in there?
I do have a question. This is probably more for Rachel. We've been using Edline for quite some time. Is it updated and kept up with current?
In terms of the building websites or the teacher websites?
No, in terms of any other software that's out there or whatever that does grades and, you know, gets out messages to parents and stuff, are they up to par with the new ones that come out? Are they, do they keep upgrading themselves, is I guess what I'm asking.
So yes, in terms of Edline and the functionality of the web page management, that
correct.
Is up to date, and there have been recent updates that we've made kind of to the look and the layout of the pages. We use the Gradebook, which interfaces with Edline, so that creates the parent portal for our middle school and high school families at this time. And in looking at a comprehensive, you know, package, if we look at anything in the future, we will of course look at all those components, but in terms of Edline meeting our needs right now, yes, it is.
It's the mm-hmm. best. Okay, thank you.
Quick question, Gary. I appreciate at the end you put the summary together with the totals. That's a good quick snapshot. Just for some of those members of our communities, where does that 602-4435, where does that stand in relation to maybe the last couple years? Is that trending pretty evenly? Is it?
It is. We add packages, like we talked about, the Destiny will eliminate packages that are either no longer or very being used very sparingly. Most of the software costs, I would say, have traditionally, you know, stayed the same or gone up just a little bit each year, trying to keep up with inflation. I would say we've been in that $500,000 to $600,000 range over the last handful of years.
And sort of in line with what Secretary Sikora was saying, there's always, especially in this line of work, there's always new, and everybody's claiming they've got the next best thing and so forth. So we've got people that are constantly looking to see if that next best thing is something that Valley View is something that we should look into, correct?
Absolutely. From the technology department standpoint, they're continually monitoring usage and basically how much are we interfacing with the products. And then from our perspective, we are monitoring, is the product meeting our needs? And is there something else out there, or is it not useful anymore? So, for example, we just recently brought a couple products to end of life, meaning, as a nice way to say, we don't need them any longer. The usage wasn't there. We found alternate products that were perhaps free or were a different solution that would meet our needs. And so, yes, we are continually monitoring and reviewing these.
I'd just like to make sure that we, and our IT department is tremendous, and the technology people are great. Just make sure we're utilizing all the little nuances that each of these programs offers, and, oh, wow, I didn't know that that could do that or whatever. So just, yeah, we just want to make sure that we're getting the biggest bang for our buck.
We are, and so for even for some of our existing products, we have refreshers on what they can currently offer that maybe we weren't aware of, or that something that is maybe enhanced in their product. And then oftentimes other solutions develop that kind of make that previous solution no longer necessary. So we are constantly monitoring that.
On some of the software, are all the teachers required to use all the software? And I'm thinking especially about, I know that when my kids were in the school, they all didn't use, I guess it would be called Edline, where they post grades and all. Is there a requirement, or is that still kind of?
There are some minimum expectations in terms of teachers' web pages, in terms of the minimum content they're required to use. Some teachers go well above and beyond, and I mean, you could pretty much follow along their class by how much content they put on there and how up to date they keep it. That is not standard across the board, but the expectation for the minimum information and the expectation for communication is the same for all of our teachers.
What would be that minimum expectation?
The minimum expectation depends on level. We kind of have it like a short list basically for middle school and for high school, and that includes contact information, course syllabus, information related to materials for the courses. Drawing a blank.
Does it include grades?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, okay. Their grade book. I'm sorry. Okay. I'm just talking about the web page, but it definitely includes the link to their grade book, which is updated weekly, and that's what the parent view can see.
Mm-hmm. That's a huge for the parents out there. I think it's every Thursday that the parents go through.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have a computer or if you have access to get onto the VVSD website, there's no reason why you will not know what your son or daughter, where they stand as of that day. So use that Edline, because it's a phenomenal tool.
Yes, and that is definitely one aspect that all teachers are required to have for middle and high school.
I have a question about the annual renewal cost. Is it a contractual thing? So like for the next 3 years, we're gonna pay X amount, or does it change every year?
Some are multi-year renewals, some are year-to-year. I think there's two there listed with an asterisk that are estimates at this time. We just don't have the final numbers. All of these, several years back, we aimed to bring them all with a fiscal year end of life, if you will, and that makes a lot of sense. And so when we bring the action report to the next meeting, you'll have the final cost. But like I said, some are year to year and some are multi-year.
Thank you.
Second action report, or I'm sorry, information report surrounds the Oakview boiler plant replacement. It is original to the building, about 34 years old, and you can see there as it's written that we've had some tube failure, which has allowed us to take a lot closer inspection, noting some corrosion on the internal structure and tubing. And so at this time we are proposing to replace the full heating plant with a new high efficiency boiler. The methodology we would use to bring that forward is similar to what we did at Brooks, where we would use an ESCO company, Performance Services, and that was part of the reason we entered into that master agreement, which is what we did when we did the Brooks project, to allow us to do some of these other projects under this master contract umbrella. And so certainly we would have legal look at that, but they would go out, procure bids, all open book pricing, and guarantee some energy savings, which is part of the statute as it relates to an energy service company, and bring that to you on June 15th. And so unless you had any objections, we would proceed with putting that out to bid. That's all I have.
Okay. Information report 14.3 is sharing information with you tonight regarding grades K-8 STEM initiative. That stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math. I'd like to invite Director of Mathematics and Science for Pre-K-5, Adam Herder, and Director of Mathematics and Science for 6-12, Christy Vay, up to the podium. And they, along with our teacher reps, will share some information with you about this recommendation that they have as we bridge into this more deeply into this world of STEM.
Good evening again. We are here for a short information piece. We want to bring to your attention STEM integration. You've heard it a little bit with our first STEM contest that we had at the middle school level. We have several courses at the middle-high level that are addressing STEM topics, and we'd like to really get this integrated further and move things along. Our students are looking for a way to bring science, technology, engineering, and mathematics as a interdisciplinary piece. And so with the adoption of the next generation science standards, we're looking at how we can bring all of these pieces together. And so the 2015-2016 school year is going to be the process of continuing our evolution of STEM curriculum and opportunities for students. Define STEM is a K-8 instructional resource that we found that focuses on science, technology, engineering, and math. Some of the pieces of Define STEM is it's an online and print platform. It allows teachers to provide an application of STEM knowledge to students through the use of project-based learning tied to real-world careers that gives them reading, writing, and math activities with rubrics. We're going to look at Define STEM as a bridge. It's not a full curriculum. It's a resource to support the integration of the Common Core State Standards for Literacy and Science, Literacy and Science, as well as the Next Generation Science Standards. In terms of Define STEM, just some highlights for you. It gives every single standard aligned to math and literacy and next generation. And so it allows the teacher to kind of hone in on the integration across all standards and be able to support students. We're looking for next year to give the resources to support our students with this integration and kind of look for full implementation of the next generation science standards for that 2016-2017 school year. And so this would just be an excellent core resource in our K-8 classrooms to help us with these important shifts. I'm going to ask our two teacher reps to come up for a brief introduction about Define STEM in their classrooms. They've been piloting, and we have a second grade teacher with us from Irene King, Michelle, and a sixth grade teacher with us from Jane Addams, Jennifer Burke.
Hi, I'm Michelle. I teach second grade at Irene King. And here are just some pictures and a sample of some of the work that we did in my classroom. I chose the gardening project because we had some background knowledge with that from things we've worked on previously in the year. We also did a health unit where we talked about eating healthy and making healthy food choices, and that was all part of using this topic. So I created the graphic organizer and just wrote, create a garden, and I said, what do you know? And so everything in blue are just all the different ideas that they came up with. And then they started coming up with questions. Well, what about this and what about this? So I said, oh, let's write those down. So then we wrote those down in pink, and then we started making connections from different areas and how knowing about this would help us with this. And so we connected those with another color, and they just took off. I really didn't give them a lot of introduction. There's some videos on here that I showed. We just started with what they knew, and they just really took off with it. They had working together. They did research on computers. We looked at seeds. We planted seeds. We talked about those. They drew some vegetables. There's just tons of projects on there, and they just had a great time really getting into it and really just taking on their own learning with that project. So that's what we did.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Burke. I teach 6th and 7th grade at Jane Addams. So these pictures are of my students, and Define STEM I've used as a resource as I'm piloting with 6th grade this year for NGSS standards. How I'm using it is to different sources. One is the video clips that they recommend, and I'm using that for building background information on vocabulary. So instead of memorizing a definition, we use those video clips, discuss them as a class, as their group, and they formulate their own definition based on their experience. The second piece that Define STEM has offered us is a huge amount of articles this year, current event articles. That's in one spot. So we are currently in sixth grade working on a volcanology unit. So the students in the bottom picture, it's difficult to see, but they have these blue articles, and so they were doing graffiti boards, which is the picture in the left. So every time they would rotate to a new poster sheet, they would get a new article. So the new article would be a new topic on the volcano. So that graffiti board would just increase their knowledge as they were building it. The students in the right-hand picture are using articles where they are connecting it to watersheds and how is it impacting watersheds. So they actually have a map and they're tracing the watersheds in the state of Illinois for how that is occurring. We looked at Illinois as a connection, not that we have volcanoes in Illinois, but it's something that they're familiar with that they could build a connection to. So those are the two pieces that we found that are the most helpful to them, and it is a lot, that source is a lot easier to go to one source to find about 20 different articles that you can use. The articles do come in different reading levels, so you can have the same article, but you can pick which version might be better for certain students with needs than, and have other challenging articles for students who are going to the next reading level.
Great, good evening. We just wanted to continue with a brief description of our proposal this evening. So our proposal to purchase Define STEM as a K-8 resource is based on teacher feedback, not only in these two classrooms, but also our elementary science committee had a chance to pilot these resources in their classrooms and suggested a one-year adoption. The proposal is to adopt for 1 year as basically a field test where every teacher would utilize the program and we'd get a much broader base of a pilot. Our initial pilot indicated that there are major benefits to the program, but before committing long-term, and because the Next Generation Science Standards go into effect the year after next, we feel next year is a perfect bridge year to try out the program before ultimately committing long-term if our staff at large feels that it's a productive strategy. So quickly, the fact that this is a K-8 resource is exciting. That's something we can have our students in for several years using the same platform. The students can use it on the computer, but they don't have to, depending on their acumen with technology. We also are able to access real-world application opportunities for students through the program that not only deal with science, but have literacy and math tasks embedded. And then finally, our visible learning principles that our district has adopted align very well with the Define STEM program. One key piece we want in all of our classrooms is for students to know what success looks like before they begin to actually do the work and conduct the learning. And Define STEM is excellent in this way. It offers rubrics, finished products, so students at any grade level in K through 8 can see for each of the project areas exactly what successful learning would look like before the teacher even begins the core instruction of the program. There's a few excellent resources in the program that were touched on already. There's over 200 videos that are of extreme high quality and of high interest to students. Each project area has multiple different tasks that students can complete. And the level text was talked about previously, and then staff has a whole training center with links to descriptions to assist teachers in planning the lesson so they don't have to print everything and plan for a significant amount in advance. They can watch a short video or have a short synopsis and be ready to begin the lesson immediately. So the investment in this proposal would be that all elementary and middle schools would receive an unlimited usage license, which is 17 annual building licenses at $2,750 each. for a total one-year cost out of current year budget funds of $46,000 and $750. And that would be for our one-year field test with the opportunity to extend longer term based on our experience during next school year at a discounted rate for a multiple year contract in the future if we chose to do that. We can answer any questions you may have.
I have a couple questions. One is, personally know that if a teacher does not have some kind of science background, especially elementary, that a lot of times they will not do, I assume this is hands-on visual learning type, okay, that they are very reluctant to do that type of thing. How do we make sure that the teacher is actually, you know, to have your people who adopt it, we choose teachers I know that,
sure,
yeah, okay, that will do that for us, but how do we make sure that those other teachers who are not comfortable with science will actually use the program? That's one question.
That's an excellent question, and actually it leads exactly to the elementary committee's decision to pursue this program further. Was based around the fact that it actually enters the world of science and STEM in the elementary world through a literacy-based approach. So the goal is to actually capitalize on an area that elementary teachers are very comfortable with in general, and be able to expand that literacy instruction to include science topics. So not only does it have those nonfiction texts, but it bridges out into actual projects. The program isn't as much hands-on science experiments, like making a hypothesis and testing it through like a science project. Okay. It's more projects that relate to the science and STEM topics. So an example might be a cost analysis for designing something, or drawing or designing an engineering project. So they don't actually necessarily engineer the design, but the goal is for them to learn how to create the plans for an engineering project, and then all the math and literacy that is encompassed with that.
Okay, I understand that. Still doesn't answer the question is how are we going to make sure that our teachers are actually using this program?
Adam, could you tell us a little bit about the Jonas Salk pilot and how that kind of spread just by interest and colleagues supporting one another?
Yeah, so from an accountability standpoint, to make sure it's part of the scope and sequence in the curriculum, for next year, we're working right now to embed certain projects from Defined STEM into our scope and sequence for math and science K through 5. So in the scope and sequence of what's expected to be taught in each quarter, there would be at least two Defined STEM projects that would be included in that scope and sequence. That would be what we're going into classrooms to support teachers with. And it would supplement our existing science curriculum as a bridge to our revised curriculum for next generation science standards. So it isn't just, here's your account, go in and use this as an extra resource. We're actually going to pinpoint the projects that align to the specific standards at each grade level. And so teachers will have a recommendation of which projects to choose. And then they'll also have the option to continue even further and do additional projects from the program if they chose to. And then longer term, if we chose to implement this as one of our core parts of our next generation science curriculum, it would be multiple projects each quarter as one of our core resources. Assistant Superintendent Kinder was talking about was we do have other hands-on options that we've used at Jonas Salk, for example. We piloted those hands-on science options that are a similar program. And the feedback we got from teachers and students, even for staff members who didn't have a high comfort level with hands-on science, the fact that the students are so heavily engaged in them and the resources are made really conveniently for teachers to plan and implement them, so they don't have to go to the store and buy like a bin of materials and set up all the stations. The program really guides the students well, and so teachers were able to gain a quick comfort level as they saw how quickly the students got involved.
My second question maybe is more for the teachers or Mrs. Bruno back there in the back. Is this a program that you see that our teachers, that we probably will adopt, that it will be liked by the teachers and students? Because when you switch curriculum or parts of curriculum every year, not only the cost, but also it's a lot more work for the teachers to every year, you know, different things every single year. And now you're saying, okay, next year we're going to do something different. you're just adding work to the teachers, not taking away work. So my question would be, is it that good that you see us keeping this program?
I don't see it as an NGSS curriculum, and we've piloted two other ways this year at sixth grade, and there isn't a source that we have found that is truly NGSS. So to build our bridge to it, this is a resource that we can use at the moment, along with the current textbook that we have at middle school, that gives us some more pieces that we can rely on to bring in.
This is more of a supplement or a resource more than the whole
Yes, okay. It's a supplement, not a whole curriculum that you would follow. And so it's more or less we're relying, at the middle school level, we're relying it on those resources. We have taken in my class one of the rubrics, and there was a variety for the volcanology project. There are four different rubrics. We took the four and basically reworked it to what fit our students' needs. So we took components of each one and made it a rubric of our own. So it was a great starting point there to use that you could base off of. Does that help you out?
Okay. Do these projects or experiments, are they going to incur any additional cost to the teacher or to the district?
No, not for this particular program. This is, the resources are there and it's project-based. What Adam was referring to was some hands-on science pieces that we're piloting with our elementaries as well. And those, if when we incorporate those, would incur like a replenishment cost for the certain consumable pieces, but that's always factored into our analysis and to our budgeting of, you know, what would it take to replenish that? It's part of the curriculum. It's certainly something that we need to account for. It wouldn't be expected that the teachers replenish those things. Michelle, did you want to add something?
Well, sorry. It was more literacy based. Like, it fit very nice with what I was doing. I was working on nonfiction. In literacy, so we just pulled in things about gardens, and so it fit together with what we were already doing with our literacy and our math, and so I think it all ties together. I didn't feel like it was something else I had to do. I felt like it fit in with what I was already doing, and I covered three things at the same time.
So it's really STEM L?
sure.
STEM and literacy also?
It was, yes, a little, yes.
So Secretary Sikora is going to handle it from the teacher side. I'm going to handle it from the sales side. What do we base our success on whether or not we want to spend the money? How do we measure our success?
Yeah, so there'll be a couple different ways that we'll measure success. One is obviously from our student output, how the students take to the projects and what results we're getting, if we're seeing the learning and students understand what their end result is, and if that improves with their ability to speak that and verbally clarify that for teachers. And then the next piece, we'll be looking at our teachers and how they used it, what the usage of the program was, how that looks in all classrooms, not just people who want to pilot, and see if it makes sense to move forward on that. I did want to answer Secretary Sikora's question for the middle school level. This year was our sixth grade year, as Jennifer Burke talked about. It was our pilot year, and we had a lot of people jump on board with that. We started our first training last year for NGSS for the 6-12 level with Dr. Carol Baker, who's one of the NGSS writers. We wanted to come with a new curriculum, but when we started working on all the facets, we didn't find anything that really was going to support what our teachers and students needed, and so we didn't want to spend frivolously, and so we really looked at what we could do, and we're really kind of writing our own in-house with support from a nonprofit organization out of New Jersey who has posted a lot of curricular resources. And so the team has gotten together a few times and started working on that at the sixth grade level. So this is going to be a support. And so we'll write this into the curriculum that we've mapped out. And so there won't be an option. It'll be, this is what you're doing for this quarter. Same thing with our middle school STEM project. All students are required to do that this school year as well as moving forward.
And I'd like to give accolades to our committees who are engaged in this work, similar to our committees who led the implementation for our shift to Common Core State Standards. Initially, the resources just aren't there. Textbook companies were very quick to slap a label on that said Common Core State Standard aligned, and now we're starting to see NGSS aligned. And then they really dig in and say, is this really what we need? And so they're not quick to make a decision of to say, let's just implement this program or package because it comes all together and looks pretty. They're really digging into it and saying, is this really supporting the shifts we need to see? And so, yes, this is an investment, but it's a cautious approach because it's going to provide them resources to use in a way that they know to be appropriate and true to what, you know, we need to see those shifts be. And will that be different in 3 years? Most definitely, I would say so. I mean, I would see that we will have evolved, just like we have with our Common Core implementation. But I also have great confidence that our committees are very thoughtful in the decisions that they're making, ensure that we do this the best way possible.
So when will this be brought back to the board as an action item?
This will be brought back to the board for action on June 15th. And if there's any other information that we can provide you or conversations, or if you'd like to see the program, we'd be happy to discuss that. Our teachers are really the ones who are most familiar with it, and so they can share lots more information with you as well, or anyone else that has questions. Thank you.
All righty. Moving down the agenda, legal services.
No report tonight.
AFT. No one here. Valley View Council? No one here for them. Valley View Office Personnel Council? Thank you. Any old business for the board? Any new business? Any questions from the public on actions?
Where's it supposed to be, old or new? My business.
Oh, I said old, and then I said new. Which one do you want?
The legal new counsel's over there. Which spot will it apply under?
Let's say new business.
All right, we'll put it under new business. I'm just want to read the oath that some of us who sit here took 2 years ago, and some just took at the last board meeting. It says, I do solemnly swear, and some people think that I read too fast and I talk too fast. So I'm going to try to go as slow as I possibly can. I, that's every board member's name, do solemnly swear or affirm that I will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of the member of the Board of Education of the Valley View School District in accordance with the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of the State of Illinois, and the laws of the State of Illinois, to be the best of my ability. I further swear or affirm that I shall respect taxpayers' interests by serving as a faithful protector of the school district's assets. I shall encourage and respect the free expression of opinion by fellow board members and others who seek a hearing before the board, while respecting the privacy of students and employees. I shall recognize that a board member has no legal authority as an individual, and that decisions can be made only by a majority vote at a public board meeting, and I shall abide by majority decisions of the board while retaining the right to seek changes in such decisions through ethical and constructive channel. I want to read back to you a statement that I feel has been violated by this board in the past, and I'm hoping since we reread this that we no longer do this. I shall encourage and respect the free expression of opinion by fellow board members and others who seek a hearing before the board. My other comment is to the five Valley View employees who told a lie. I want you, and you know who you are, to consider this the next time you repeat something when you think that it is true and you haven't done your homework. And I pray that if you have a concern with an issue with your fellow employees or with especially students, that you will get all the information. And so with that, I'd like to leave you five employees with this. Is it truth? This is the Rotary philosophy. I didn't come up with this. I'm not that smart. Is it fair to all concerned? Does it promote goodwill and better friendship? And will it be beneficial to all that concern? I pray that we will respect each other in every asset of our opinion.
Thank you, Member Campbell. Any other new business before the board this evening? All right, any questions from the public on actions taken by the board? Any announcements by the board?
Just a couple brief ones. First, I'd like to congratulate the Wilco Career Center. They had 172 referrals this year. And there was, Dr. Mitchum, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's just shy of 980 students total represented by all the various school districts throughout Will County. So it may sound like a lot, but just to give you an idea, not one, zero of those referrals were due to fighting or misbehaving. They were cell phone violations or kids driving to school when they should be taking the bus. So I think our hats should go off to the entire Wilco Career Center for promoting such a positive learning experience for all of the kids, but especially for the Valley View kids. And lastly, I just want to say thanks to all of the teachers, staff, administration, leadership, for a what I would deem, again, it's my own opinion, but a positive year in Valley View. I had the pleasure of being a watchdog at Pioneer a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, and it's a great program. And I just want to say, I know we thank a lot of people, but spend 2.5 hours in the lunchroom, which I did. Our lunch aides, our recess support, I don't even know what you call them, but I'll tell you, they are, and nothing against anybody else, but they are some of the hardest working people there. Our kids didn't want for anything, were treated with respect, and some of the most respect given back that I had a chance to see from kindergartners through fifth graders. So thanks to all of the lunch staff personnel and everything else out there amongst everybody else, but thank you for a great year on behalf of myself as a community member and as a board member, but most importantly as a father of some kids in the district. So thank you.
Okay, I would like to thank the building administrators for that. Those people that showed appreciation to the staff and the teachers at their schools. I read through the individual schools' accounts that Mr. Christofi puts out, not just to see the budget, but also to see what the money was spent on. And when I see that it was spent on teacher appreciation or that type of thing, I realize that what I asked for, that the administration starts showing the teachers' appreciation is being done, and I appreciate it. And if there's administrators out there not doing that, I would ask you to do that, because you get a lot more with sugar than you do the other way. Thank you.
Any announcements by the administration?
I do have one. I'd like to remind our families who will have students in summer learning experience that our orientation night for parents and students will be Wednesday, June 10th, beginning at 6:30 p.m., and that will be held at your summer learning experience school site. So please come out and join us.
I just wanted to say thank you for a job well done this year. We probably won't have another board meeting before the school year's out, so on behalf of senior leadership and senior administration, thank you to all the administrators, teachers, support staff, and everyone who engages our kids on a daily basis. Job well done.
Echo.
Just a couple reminder dates. We have the Bolingbrook High School graduation is May 31st at 1 p.m. Romeoville following that at 4 p.m. And our middle school promotion ceremonies will be June 2nd at 6:30 p.m. We also want to remind our community that on June 3rd, the last day of school, is a full day. And two other events, which I thought maybe Member Secor would have got, but the Valley View Educational Enrichment Foundation golf outing on June the 9th, correct?
Correct. All the administrators got a little note from me, nice little note.
Okay.
It wasn't a threat.
No, it wasn't a threat.
It wasn't a threat.
And we also have one other golf outing being on June 5th, Romeoville High School Athletic Boosters. I think Principal Kinder is already gone. And that one is...
That's the deadline for entering, but not exactly later than that.
Okay, so that's the deadline. I have June 5th. All right. So then it's June 19th then. Is that correct? All right. All right. Any other announcements by the public? All righty, and again, you've heard it from many of us. We've had a great year with our district and a great year with our students. We're very proud of all the work that our teachers and our administration has done, and we're very proud of our students as well. And so we wish everyone a very safe, fun summer. Get involved with we have wonderful Bolingbrook Park District events and opportunities, and we just hope that everyone will really enjoy their summer. It's a well-deserved summer, and we hopefully will have warm weather and a little bit of dry weather, right? We're all tired of the rain. So, all right. We are going to have a motion to adjourn to executive session. All right, so we need a motion to adjourn to executive session, and a second.
So moved.
Any roll call vote?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Member Butters has left. Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perro?
Yes.
Secretary Secora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes. Closed. Done.